Ozarks, for which we still have some programs here if you'd like them. You know that Ozark folk music in the Ozarks is very much alive and well, thank goodness, because it's a wonderful tradition, very, very traditional. Yesterday, Stuart Levine made the point that when we have developments in technology, that doesn't necessarily mean that the new technology drives out what there was before. When we have daguerreotypes, that doesn't mean that we have no more portrait painters. And one thread that you'll notice through the papers this morning is that with the development of media such as radio and recordings, that does not mean that we no longer have music that's performed live in the old way or in a modified way. There's a constant interplay between commercial forms, traditional forms. They blend in and out, which is one of the very provocative and frustrating things for folklorists to keep track of, but also one of the very exciting things for you all to go out and document and to be alert to. Now, part of this, the interplay is illustrated. I was looking at the record notes for the Smithsonian Collection of Classic Country Music, which is out on our table on exhibit. The very first recording in that set was made from a fiddler who was born in Arkansas, raised in Texas. It's the first documented commercial recording of a white folk musician that we have. It's Eck Robertson playing Sally Gooden, recorded in 1922, so it's now 60 years old, and that interplay has been going on ever since. Now, I'll just briefly alert you to places where you can find out more about Ozark folk music. First of all, we have left from the concert last night a list of resources which Barry Virgie has kindly brought along. If you don't have a copy, come get one after the program. There are a number of people who have collected and written about Ozark folk music. The most notable name is Vance Randall. Published a four-volume collection of Ozark folk songs in 1946-50. It's recently reissued in the four-volume format by the University of Missouri Press with an excellent introduction and survey of the literature by Bill McNeil, who's on our program this morning. And I recommend that for your attention. There is also a one-volume abridgment of that, which we just published at Illinois, with an appendix on recorded Ozark folk music. Some of this will overlap with Barry's information, which I didn't know he was going to bring. So that's where you can get started. Another person I should mention who has done extensive work in the Ozarks is Gordon McCann, who has worked with Vance Randolph in past years. And you might wish to talk to Gordon afterwards about his work. Now, for the program, we're going to reverse the order of a traditional format in the sense that we're going to begin with attention to sacred music and end up with a paper on a secular tradition and then a performance of fiddle tunes. I don't know if you play any, do you play any hymns on the fiddle, gospel songs ever?
Oh, some.
Well, maybe you could wind up your set then with the gospel song and that will make everything right.
It always does.
We'll see.
Our first speaker is David Crawford, who is a native of Fort Scott, Kansas, coming home and since chairman of the musicology and music history department at the University of Michigan, and has Wesley and Renaissance music among Herbert's fields, trained at the University of Kansas, Illinois, and worked in Vienna. And this published prolifically. I won't give you all the names of all the articles. You can ask him about that. He's speaking to us this afternoon on Albert Brumley, who was an Ozark gospel musician, songwriter, very influential person. If you check that Smithsonian set that's out on the exhibit table, again, you'll find that there are at least two songs of his that I noted, which are in there. There's Jesus Hold My Hand, they did that, as sung by the Chuck Wagon Gang, and Dreaming of a Little Cabin. And Bill Malone has very high praise for Brumley, and certainly deserving of the paper, and so if you'll tell us about Albert Brumley.
Thank you.
And could somebody lower the house lights, please?
Thank you, Judith. That's a little too dark. When Judith introduced this session as Ozark folk music, I got a little nervous because some purists could get into quite a bit of debate about what is folk music and what isn't. Just for the record, I'm avoiding the expression here, simply because it also falls into the field of popular music. I'm just avoiding the debate about whether or not this is folk. One of Mr. Brumley's best songs sounds a little like this.
Just a few more weary days and then joy shall never end. I'll fly away, fly away. I'll fly away, fly away for glory. I'll fly away, fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away, fly away.
Driving in the country. Sometimes those drives would enter a quiet valley of Powell, Missouri. At one point where a bridge spanned this small stream, her mother would point to a house and say, "That's where Albert Brumley lives." Mr. Brumley died in 1977, but some things remain unchanged. Parents still point to the house and say to their children, "That's where Albert Brumley lived." Mr. Brumley not only distinguished himself as a local hero, he also earned a national reputation as one of the most important and influential songwriters of gospel music of our era. Today I want to tell you a few things about Mr. Brumley, and I also wish to suggest some of the complex interplay between local and national performance ideals. Complicating the picture is the fact that Midwestern country folk can take delight in more than one approach to performance. As is well known, early performances drew heavily upon the male quartet, usually with piano accompaniment. Some recordings from the late 1920s, the Stamps All-Stars, for example, reinforce my theme of intermingling styles, where their pianist threw in some ragtime against the more conventional quartet singing. The combination of the two attitudes toward rhythm became a long-lasting feature, as demonstrated by the excerpt we have already heard. Most of Mr. Brumley's 800 songs were written in Powell and sung in the Ozarks at family gatherings, by church congregations, at singing conventions and other social gatherings, and by professional and semi-professional groups. Today I shall focus on the professionals who issue commercial recordings. I purchased these records by mail order or at regional record shops, Bible stores, and gospel sings. Albert Brumley was born near Spiro, Oklahoma in 1905. In his early years, he played some square dance fiddle and learned to read music at the Hartford Music Institute in Hartford, Arkansas. He sang in gospel quartets and played the piano. Once in a conversation with me, he tripped slightly over the word nostalgia, and he referred to his schooling by explaining, "I only went to night school, so I can't talk very well during the day." This is the beautiful city skyline of downtown Powell. And Mr. Brumley arrived here in 1931. He gave a 10-day singing school, then married a local girl, and settled down to save. Before the days of success when music supported him and his family, he worked for his father-in-law in the general store. He told me that, in the early years, moral codes frowned upon close associations within mixed company unless the people were a family, and this contributed to the popularity of the male quartet. The code did, however, allow families to form professional groups, and in this way, women's voices entered the scene. One such group began in the 1930s was the Chuck Wagon Gang. Judith, in fact, mentioned the Chuck Wagon Gang performance in introducing me. This gang came from Lubbock, Texas. In 1936, Mr. Brumley brought out It's an Unfriendly World. Today we shall hear one chorus of this song as sung by the Chuck Wagon Gang. This performance is a conservative one, preserving most of the original voice leading.
Here I was,
are in major keys, but sometimes with notated lowered thirds, as in this chorus. Many performers regard thirds as negotiable. If they're uncomfortable with notated blues effects, the thirds may be sung squarely major. Perhaps this is another case of social values influencing performance practice, for other gospel musicians, apparently less concerned about invoking the sounds of secular life, may add many lowered thirds, even in pieces where that pitch is never indicated. Mr. Brumley subtitled some pieces spiritual. Once he demonstrated this style by singing a few phrases to me. Then, a bit embarrassed, he confessed, "I can still carry a tune all right, but I can't unload it so well anymore." Today's introduction to performance traditions can conclude with a reminder of a different Ozark tradition, the string band that gave rise to bluegrass. So, here's an excerpt of the quartet tradition, but as modified by the instruments of Bill Monroe and the Bluegrass Boys. "Jesus Hold My Hand" was written by Mr. Brumley in 1939, the same year as Monroe's opening at the Grand Ole Opry. Beginning of this paper, we sampled one of Mr. Brumley's most famous songs of 1932, "I'll Fly Away." This piece is known to almost every gospel, country, and bluegrass musician today. Mr. Brumley told me that he sold the rights to the song for $3. By 1943, he had learned his lesson, and Powell got another business establishment, a publishing house. This is his son, Bob, standing beside the sign. Sorry to say, Bob had meant to be with us today, but I don't see him back there, so obviously he's tied up. Having mentioned some early mainstreams of the regional performance ideals, we might now hear something else, an early 1970s version by the Rambo Sisters. By this time, the country music is a national phenomenon, so these Kentucky girls are singing the music from Powell at a church in downtown Minneapolis. The spread of gospel music to the national music industry gained strength in the 1950s, and I dealt with that subject a few years in the Journal of Popular Culture. The following excerpt reminds us that one of the historian's sources, the notation, can fail to tell much about performance. I'll Fly Away, like other gospel songs, was published as a part song, and these performers have a different view of troping the urtext.
Convention song, and I want you to smile now, and a little further down into it, put your hands together and kind of jam in with us. It goes something like this. Some glad morning, some of these happy, happy, happy sunshine morning. Well, I said some glad morning when the slave. Put it my way. We're to her land. Oh, God, celestial shore.
We don't have time for Wendell. As this sample recitative and aria suggests, the transition to the national marketplace in the 1950s was accompanied by changes in performance practice. Nasal vocal qualities became less conspicuous and vibrato more common. Instruments were electrically amplified and multiple microphones became common during the 1960s. Increasing vocal virtuosity emphasized higher tenors and lower basses. The microphones helped balance the singers in their extreme ranges and also permitted greater movement on the stage. Additional instruments became available, amplified and steel guitars, and sometimes electronic organs. Instrumental virtuosity, electronic know-how, trap drums, black tuxedos, and grand pianos signal the Ars Nova. This enhanced role of instruments can be viewed as consistent with the earlier popularity of the string band. Also, arrangements may change tempos and keys to increase excitement, and nobody ever worries about returning to the original tonic. Recordings became more important, for the good years after the war brought electricity and phonographs to many rural homes. I illustrate with an excerpt from When We Sing Around the Throne Eternal, performed by Holy Lister and the Statesman. As another example of gospel music spread into the chilly north, several years ago, a wall in the men's washroom at Michigan School of Music bore this inscription. Hobie Lister lives. Although I spend much time studying manuscripts, I have never been able to identify this scribe. Getting my camera in there to take this picture wasn't all that easy either. Here's a picture of the Statesman with Hobie Lister at a grand piano. You see the three mics. Note also the portrayal of happiness, and you can also hear it, even when they sing about death. Showing that these people love to sing. 50 years ago, the British folklorist Cecil Sharp wrote of American country people that singing was, and I quote, almost as universal a practice as speaking. 10 years later, George Pullen Jackson noted something similar when he stated that, by contrast, city folk do not sing. I observed this love for singing when I attended the Sundown to Sunup Gospel Sing in Springdale, Arkansas, sponsored by the Brumley family and the Springdale Chamber of Commerce. These all-night sessions draw about 7,000 people a night, so many that the only practical place to hold this is the rodeo arena. People come from hundreds of miles to attend the all-night sessions featuring professional groups. The horses and wagons that once brought music lovers to singing schools and conventions are replaced by family cars and overnight campers. Old friends are reunited, and families may while away the day in conversation or ball games or horseshoe matches. The afternoon highlight is a talent contest. Some contestants preserve traits of true country music, but others aspire to modern pop or rock styles. So, the interplay between local and outside musicianship exists at the amateur as well as the professional level. The usual winners are the primarily vocal groups, either families or friends, who have made fewer compromises with the long-standing vocal ensemble traditions. These groups are busy all year, singing at churches, community gatherings, and for radio and TV. If their jobs are flexible, a next step will be to schedule tours. At this point, they may get a camper or an old bus. Here's a typical parking area for amateur groups: cars, vans, campers, and a few buses. The stars travel in custom-designed air-conditioned buses. Such a bus has a plush TV lounge and individual compartments, complete with excellent sound systems for each musician. Their compartments convert into small bedrooms so they can sleep on the road, but touring is still hard work. I talked with one group that sang in Washington, D.C. one evening, rode 1,300 miles to step on stage in Arkansas at 10 o'clock the next night, remained there the next night to close the show at about 3 a.m., then bused to Minnesota for the next evening's booking, and 24 hours later found them on stage in West Virginia. Numerous professional groups take turns on the stage at Springdale, but the traditional finale is performed by the Blackwood brothers singing goodbye with a Brumley metaphor, "I'll meet you in the morning." The Blackwood brothers were the first group to tour by bus, also the first to bring gospel music to nationwide TV by winning the Arthur Godfrey Talent Scouts in 1954. Like some other gospel groups, today they project a more modern image. As the song goes on, James Blackwood, beloved by these audiences because he has been a professional lead tenor for about 50 years, steps forward. As the excitement mounts, he tropes the song with some sermonettes between verses, goes into the audience with his hand mic, shaking hands with people, and eventually ends the number standing on a chair, shouting, singing, and gesturing to the audience. The ensemble is singing on the stage at your right, and he is down there in the middle of the crowd, dressed in white. Close up, it looks like this. Some of the audience is roused to its feet, sometimes clapping and sometimes shouting. This atmosphere of raw emotions is reminiscent of the old-time camp meeting. In the next excerpt, you will hear an interesting musical detail. When the lead tenor sings the fifth of a tonic chord, the first tenor might take the tonic a fourth higher. If they are in good voice and at the tops of their ranges, they have at it, bringing out a boisterous open fourth at the top of the ensemble. This effect is squarely within country tradition, but gospel groups rarely use it on recordings. My primitive cassette caught a bit of it, and even James's signal to his younger brother Cecil shouted out now.
To the wonderful gift of this great man, Mr. Albert E. Brumley, I want to sing it one more time. I hope he hears me all the way up in Powell, Missouri tonight. I want you to join me. Let's sing it. Yes, I'll be.
Mr. Brumley spoke of himself as a songwriter rather than a composer, and stressed the importance of memorable tunefulness in simple melodies. His emphasis upon melody is no accident. He recognized one of the pleasures of country life. In contrast to our life patterns, these people spend large portions of their time working in the quiet and solitude of the outdoors. In that setting, a haunting tune is a welcome companion. The spread of gospel music across the country also led to some smooth pop arrangements. Here are a few bars of memorable tunes from If We Never Meet Again.
If we never meet again, the sight of heaven, as we struggle through this world and this world.
This young gospel singer from Mississippi joined the Black Brothers for a while before going on to other things. I saw him perform in Ann Arbor a year before his death, and part of the show included a gospel quartet. If you haven't recognized him, here's the album cover. Elvis once told Mr. Brumley that If We Never Meet Again was his mother's favorite song and that it was sung at her funeral. Mr. Brumley's personality is nicely revealed in his poetry, and I want to reflect over that before you hear the last performance today. His comment about portrait painting in the 19th century is still alive and well. He was a quiet and humble man, but his irrepressible good humor led him to list the three B's as Bach, Beethoven, and Brumley. His texts reflect simplicity by favoring short words. Most have only one syllable, but this is not due to a weak vocabulary. One of his delights was taking on the crossword puzzles in the New York Times. Short words help minimize conflicts between text accents and melody. Also, he never has to impale the voice on an unattractive, awkward word, and meanings are always clear. He did not bother with a rhyming dictionary, but his rhymes rarely sound contrived. Sometimes he avoids artificiality by accepting false rhymes, but rarely with such verve as in the recent gospel-style hit by a gospel group, Elvira, My Heart's on Fire. Most of his texts invoke the first person. They are meditations from the poet's point of view. They never threaten damnation, nor is there a trace of social protest. Earthly hardships exist, but he is satisfied that they will resolve, to quote one of his favorite metaphors, on the other shore. Biblical references are rare. Instead, he draws heavily upon the powerful images of family, friends, the beauties of nature, singing, and nostalgia for old-time customs. Some of these characteristics are heard in this performance of I Couldn't Begin to Tell You.
If I had all the beautiful pictures of nature, the sea, and the land, and if I spoke in a voice never ending, speaking only of loveliness, I couldn't begin to tell you how beautiful heaven is. If I mixed all the glorious sunsets with the fathomless mysteries of Mars, if I mixed all the beauty of springtime with the gleam of the moon and the stars, if I added the love of all mothers, and the thrill of a baby's kiss, I couldn't begin to tell you how beautiful heaven is.
Gospel musicians fairly often recite their texts as poetry. Here is a picture of that group with Mr. Brumley. The curiously named Cathedral Quartet stands in front of a log cabin with an electric wire barely visible above the trees. The picture is no fake. You find electricity and log cabins in the hills around Powell. Similarly, the give and take between local and national musicianship shapes performances from the 1920s to the present. The classical simplicity survives. Thank you.
I'd like to ask for maybe two or three questions, and then we'll move on fairly quickly, and we can possibly pick up some more questions later on. Does somebody have a burning question for Professor Crawford after this very fine paper that he's given us? Yes, sir.
Did the Bromley Publishing Company grow out of the Hartford, or did he establish the publishing company before he bought the Hartford? I think he did.
There's a very interesting story to that. After I'll Fly Away and some of his early 30s songs turned out to be worth so much, he tried to buy the rights to I'll Fly Away back, and he couldn't get them, because the Hartford Music Company wouldn't release them. So he just bought the whole company. And that's really what set him up in business in Powell.
When, what was the date on?
43. A lot with recordings. He handed me this thing, which he produced just as we were coming in, and he's chief consultant for the big Time Life series of country and western records. Here are three brochures for three of the records in the series, all done very nicely, so you keep a track of that. Now he's going to speak to us on a group called the McDonald Brothers, about whom I'm anxious. I don't know much about them. Early professional gospel music in Missouri, plays Case of the McDonald Brothers.
Okay. Most of you have probably never heard of the McDonald Brothers, so I'm going to have the privilege of introducing them. The story starts one hot afternoon in Birmingham, Alabama, August 6, 1927. Four young men from Missouri climbed up to the third floor of the Star Piano Company building at 1820 3rd Avenue North. When they got to the top of the stairs, puffing and slightly wilted from the stifling Alabama humidity, they found themselves in a makeshift recording studio. Old blankets had been hung around the walls, the glass partitions had been removed, and a platform constructed in the center of the room. A month before, the Jeanette Recording Laboratories, a subsidiary of the Star Piano Company, had moved some $275,000 worth of electronic recording equipment into the Birmingham site, and they had begun to make master records on thick wax for local talent. The nation looks to the South for its Dixie melodies, its jazz orchestras, and its hot music, said a Mr. Soul, who was the head of the recording team when he arrived in Birmingham. And by the time the young boys from Missouri had arrived on the scene, The outfit had recorded some 103 selections by a wide variety of artists. Jazz bands, blues singers, harmonica players, fiddle bands, reciters, whistlers, black jubilee quartets, white sacred harp groups, and a Hawaiian guitar player who did a piece called Yamakita. As the young man from Missouri waited quietly, a blues singer named Otis Martin finished recording a song called The Police and the High Sheriff Come Riding Down. And then it was their time. The boys introduced themselves as the McDonald Brothers. They were from Kennett, Missouri. And they had been singing together ever since they were kids. In fact, the oldest brother was still only 23, and the group's baritone was only 14. None of the brothers was really old enough to have a voice deep enough to sing bass, so a neighbor from back in Missouri, Mr. W.E. Smithmeyer, had volunteered to sing bass until somebody's voice changed. The four singers were touring the South in the summer of 1927, and they found out by accident about the recording tryouts in Birmingham while they were there in the city. They gave their names and addresses to the secretary, did a quick tryout song, and then stepped up on the platform to begin the recording. A local piano player had been recruited for the occasion, and the boys loaned him one of the paperback songbooks they were singing from. It was called His Voice of Love, and it had been published by the James D. Bond Company 3 years earlier in Lawrenceburg, Tennessee. It was published in a notation style system that utilized seven shape notes. The song that the boys chose to start with was one called Working for the Master. And here's the way they sounded on that distant summer day some 55 years ago. I apologize for the very scratchy 78 that you're going to be hearing. By listening to it. The style would go on to become a standard feature of rural gospel music, and one which is still used some today. The McDonald's recorded one other song and then went back downstairs to resume their touring. A few months later, the record was issued, and it was such a success that the record company issued it on 8 different labels over the next 3 years, including one sold by mail order by the Sears catalog. The record sold well enough that the McDonald's soon found themselves called back into recording studios again and again and again from 1928 until their retirement in 1975. The McDonald's managed to record for every major record company and to perform in settings that ranged from the old-time medicine shows to the state singing conventions to funerals and to the platforms of country music stars like the Delmore Brothers and Red Foley. When the brothers broke up for the first time in 1955, Their radio show was heard on some 217 stations in 12 states, and their live television show was seen by thousands. They were undoubtedly the most famous quartet to come out of the Missouri-Arkansas area, and their career is a splendid microcosm of how gospel music grew up and professionalized and became a dominant force in grassroots American music. In fact, it has become a force today that is so strong that it currently sells twice the number of records that jazz and classical music does, and six times the volume of records that folk music does. A microcosm, perhaps, but a rather odd one. For even though the McDonalds were in the very center of the gospel quartet movement, they knew all the important people. In fact, Albert Brumley used to play piano with them on tours. They recorded all of the important songs, were associated with many of the major companies, and in spite of all of this, something very odd happens when you try to fit them into the generally accepted pattern of the development of gospel music. Over and over again, their career flies in the face of our notions of the development and effect of gospel music. Are the McDonalds unusual, or is our approach to the music wrong? For the rest of the paper, I want to explore this question and to discuss the McDonald brothers' case history against which we may test the adequacies or inadequacies of the current scholarship on this sort of music. First, let me present the case for the prosecution. Item one, the problem of how early quartets became full-time professional singers. Most writings from the various earliest works of Archie Green and Bill Malone to the more recent studies by Stan Grobston suggest that virtually all the gospel quartets at the dawn of gospel music in the late 1920s were creatures of the powerful songbook publishers. James D. Vaughan, one of the local giants, did indeed, quote, invent, unquote, the gospel quartet about 1912 as a device to help publicize his new song. And many, many quartets in the 1920s were in fact paid by the company. Generally considered to have been the first fully professional group was the Chuckwagon Gang in the mid-1930s. This supposedly was the first independent group. Yet as we actually begin documenting the career of these early groups, interviewing survivors, studying phonograph records, looking at commercial documents, we find a number of groups, including the McDonald Brothers, who were fully independent as early as the 1920s. The McDonalds did indeed sell songbooks. At one point, they would carry songbooks from three different publishers with them. But they were never paid by the companies and never owned by the companies. They simply bought the songbooks by getting a 50% discount in large lots for resale at concerts. These paperback songbooks, I should have brought one, for some of you might not have seen them. They were about the size of a large paperback novel. They contained about 120 songs, and they sold usually for a quarter apiece, but if you bought them in lots of 100, you could get them for half that. So the McDonalds were able to combine income from record royalties, from book sales, from concert receipts, and were making a comfortable living long before the Chuckwagon Gang. Okay, item two, the quote, southernness of gospel quartet singing. For years, popular commentators have been quick to associate quartet music with the South. This is a trend encouraged by early publishers like Vaughan, who in early advertising in the 1920s himself insisted with a jingoistic single-mindedness that his records were good because they were made south of the Mason-Dixon line. He used to say in his ad, these Vaughan quartet records are appropriate for any young boy and girl in the South. So this, to some extent, has been with us for a long time. Even today, the term Southern Gospel is still used as a code word for white quartet music by trade publications like Billboard and Record World. I guess I shouldn't say Record World since they went defunct last week, but let's say Cashbox. The case of the McDonald brothers suggests that gospel music was at least equally popular in the Midwest as it was in the South. Ralph McDonald, for example, the baritone for the quartet, recalled that the big states the brothers played in were not Alabama and Mississippi and Tennessee, but rather were Missouri, Indiana, Illinois, and Arkansas. Southern Illinois especially was a fertile base for the McDonalds, and for years they made their radio base at towns like Clinton, Springfield, and Decatur. It's worth noting, too, in this regard, that it was in Shenandoah, Iowa, that the Blackwood Brothers, doubtless the most commercially successful of all the modern quartets, gained their initial fame. And to note that cultural geographer Doyne Horsley has located as many modern audience, they had to include non-gospel material in their concerts. Even on records, they did numbers like Down in Arkansas, Gypsy Love Song, Roll on Blue Moon, and a novelty item called McDonald's Farm. And even today, Ralph McDonald, sitting in retirement in his farm in Lexington and 78 years old, is still proud of the group's triple yodel that they used to do on a song called Way Out There. Now, a triple yodel, as Roth explained it to me, is a yodel in which you have two-part harmony yodel along with the primary yodel, and it's very difficult to do it. McDonald also recalls, and I quote, "We sang a lot of non-gospel tunes back in those days. People didn't know much about it. Of course, in later years, they got to where they blackballed you if you didn't do all gospel. But back in the 1920s, all the groups did some novelty numbers, and just about all of them had some comedy skits as well. We had one of the best comedy skits around. It was called Dr. Revelations, in which we did a takeoff on black preaching along with some singing, and it would run to 30 or 35 minutes on stage." This brings up item four, the idea that black and white gospel music was, again in the 30s and 40s, somehow compartmentalized. In one of the leading books on white gospel music, a book called The Wings of a Dove, which is about the only general history now available, the author virtually ignores the possibility of black and white interplay, and in Tony Heilbutt's Gospel Sound, which is the only effective book on black gospel music, Heilbutt completely ignores white music. So here again, if we look in the 30s and actually talk to the people who were around then, we find that things were a lot looser and freer in the old days than they became later. The McDonald's in the 1930s recalled touring with a lot of noted black gospel groups. They actually did concert tours with the Golden Gate Quartet and with the legendary Chicago singer Sally Martin. They presumably saw no hypocrisy in doing Dr. Revelations while at the same time admiring and respecting black gospel singers. For many years, the McDonald's traveled with Cleavock Derrick, who was the nation's foremost black shape note composer, a composer, incidentally, whose career had been almost totally neglected. We don't even know where he was born. But his songs, like Just a Little Talk with Jesus and We'll Soon Be Done with Troubles and Trials, have become standards for hundreds of white groups. Item five, the idea that gospel, like country or blues, was derived heavily from tradition. There's much romanticism about gospel music, and there has been from the time of George Pullen Jackson on, and it extends all the way up to the most recent issue of the Foxfire book. But as early as the turn of the century, this music was being filtered through a very complex publishing and distribution system. And once the full scope of this remarkable grassroots publishing system is understood, the gushy effusions about, quote, stately old mountain hymns will have to suffer some serious revisionism. Though all the McDonald brothers were exposed to traditional music as children, they remember, for example, traveling around the neighborhood in Kennett to different musicals held in different homes. They were soon fully immersed in the commercial end of the music. Many of their records, even in 1928, were what we today would call cover versions of earlier hits by other groups. They often worked out deals whereby a songwriter, including Brumley, would tour with them as their pianist, and in turn, they would feature his songs in Barter systems also dominated early bookings. As Ralph McDonald explained it, would have a quartet, let's say, from Texas, want to come through our territory. this is kind of interesting. I've been able to detect that all the early quartets kind of had their own little territory, territorial imperative sort of thing worked out. And they were pretty much confined to working in this area. In any event, if a group from Texas wanted to come through our territory, we'd certainly let them do it, and we'd do a swap out, and then they would have to have us tour through their territory. The McDonalds, unlike a lot of early country or blues singers, seldom wrote any original material. Like most quartets, they were interpreters of other songs, and even today, they remember very little about the ideational content of the songs. In many ways, of course, the McDonalds were rather typical of early commercial gospel groups. Their style was relatively restrained and technically quite polished. Their songs were drawn from the huge stock of material produced in the 1920s and 30s and published in the familiar paperback twice per year songbooks, full of commonplace images, diction, and sentiment. They did not especially have strong geographic ties. They worked more for the Bond Company in Tennessee or the Stamps Baxter songbooks in Texas, or they sold Morris Henson songbooks from Georgia, and they seemed to sell more of these songbooks than they'd sold for any of the Arkansas firms. You would have expected them, since there were about 12 to 15 songbook publishers in Arkansas, to have sold some of their books, but they apparently did not. They didn't either especially favor songs from writers from the Ozarks. They did record stuff by Brumley. They also recorded some material by Luther Presley. But by and large, they didn't record any more songs by Ozark's composers than they did other composers. Still, for years, they continued to be based in West Tennessee or in the Southeast Missouri area, not only performing, but even booking and staging other groups. Ralph McDonald, in fact, when I talked to him 2 days ago to confirm a couple of details for this paper, wanted to know whether I was interested in booking any quartets through my area. Okay, I begin this talk with a detailed account of one incident in the McDonald brothers' career. I cherish such details because I feel that they are one of the few ways to start to construct an accurate history of this much neglected and little chronicled music. It cannot be done accurately from the three approaches that so far have been used in gospel study. The bibliographic approach, which is focused pretty much on little more than songbooks and song texts, with scant knowledge of the economic and cultural forces that generated such books. The folkloristic approach, which finds wonders in the hymns of the primitive Baptists, but indifference to the myriad family quartets which flourish alongside them, and which is virtually helpless in the face of having to reconstruct a history of groups long since departed or dead. Or the third approach, the country music approach, which blithely assumes that gospel is a subgenre of country music, and that it went through parallel stages in its development and commercialization. Well, gospel music is really none of these things, and a totally different musical and cultural species unto itself. Its history has not yet yielded to any of the older approaches, and it will not before a lot more facts are compiled. This means more interviews with the main participants in the music, more understanding of just how it worked. It means a broader, more holistic approach that puts aside prejudice and hostility toward fundamentalist religion and the moral simplicities of the songs, and that puts aside the romanticism that distorts the folk aesthetic, that approves for study a community's bluegrass band, black church choir, or primitive Baptist congregations, but ignores the same community's most popular form of cultural expression, the gospel quartet music or the family singing group. The case of the McDonald brothers, built from hundreds of tiny but hard-won facts like these, reminds us primarily of the danger of rushing into generalizations where evidence is scant and of creating a fancied history of a music and a portrait of a culture that might never have existed in the real world. Thank you.
Was a publication, an earlier one, called Good Old Songs. I believe the author was Casey Thornton, Arkansas, used by such groups in the 20s, perhaps later.
They generally tended, those songs were available to them. The books were certainly available to them, but
The McDonald's, they were, again, young, hot groups, and they wanted fairly recent songs. And most of the time, what they would record would be songs that were had been written 3 or 4 years earlier. So they would try their very best to get fairly new songs. And they tended generally to stay away from the older things.
We have another question for Charles while Bill McNeil is getting set up with the slides here.
Charles, are there earlier recordings available, and have they been re-released or not?
Unfortunately not. That's part of the prejudice I was talking about. The record companies that are very anxious to release records by the Skillet Lickers or Skip James, don't get too excited by the McDonald Brothers or some of the other early groups. So unfortunately, there are not at this point really much in the way of white gospel reissues. I can document about 100 that were done for major companies, and then they went into business for themselves and started producing their own records in the late 1940s, and I have no idea of how many of those they may have produced, because they like a lot of the groups, they figured out about 1948 that they could produce their own records on their own labels, and once you do that, our standard notions of discography just go out the window, but we have no idea how many there are.
Paper in the last formal presentation of the afternoon comes to us from William Payne McNeil, who's a doctor in folklore from Indiana University and is presently folklorist at the Ozark Folk Center in Mountain View, Arkansas, or local or Ozark resident. He's been working on, among other things, a history of folklore scholarship up to 1900. Bibliography of Anglo-American gospel music. He's also been involved with recordings and was involved with issuing this very interesting LP to look at. And as I mentioned earlier, provided a very fine introduction to the Missouri reprint of Vance Randolph's book, Ozark Folk Song. This is Vance Randolph, smiling. And he's going to talk to us today about Dr. Smith's champion Ozark Pullers and Ozark String Band.
Most writers dealing with the history of early country music have overemphasized Appalachian musicians and underemphasized those from the Ozarks. Perhaps this is understandable, since most recordings during the years from 1923 to 1932 were by Appalachian-based performers. Also, to some extent, the emphasis is justified, for few Ozark musicians produced any national hits. Among the first were Missouri's Weaver Brothers and Elvira and Arkansas's Elton Britt, but their recording fame was realized after 1932. Finally, there were few Ozark groups that were long-lived. Most of them made only a single recording session that disappeared. For example, Pope's Arkansas Mountaineers, one of the most popular Ozark string bands recorded during the 1920s, had only one session in 1928, even though their records sold fairly well throughout the South. Certainly no Ozark group compared to longevity with North Georgia's Gid County and the Skillet Lickers, who in various forms survived for a decade and a half. Perhaps the longest-lived Ozark string band recorded during the 1920s, and without question one of the largest mountain groups ever recorded, was Dr. Smith's Champion Horsehair Pullers, a group based in the tiny Arkansas mountain town of Calico Rock. The moving force behind the Horsehair Pullers was Dr. Henry Harlan Smith, one of Izard County's leading citizens and a tireless supporter of Ozark culture. He was born May 16, 1881, 3 miles from Calico Rock in the small community of Spring Creek. After attending neighborhood school, Smith enrolled in Barn Forks College, spelled Barron but pronounced Barn, in preparation for medical training. Upon graduation in 1906, he returned to Calico Rock, and at that time he was appointed local surgeon for the Missouri Pacific Railroad, post he held until his death in 1931. Smith was more than just a good doctor. He was also one of the most popular local citizens, a good community organizer, and a person who took great interest in his hometown and the welfare of its residents. He was also a public relations man par excellence, a matter testified by the fact that he was able to persuade the organizers of the county fair to have it in Calico Rock rather than the county seat in Melbourne, which was the usual fair site. In the mid-1920s, he built a small cafe where he showed motion pictures 6 nights a week. This venture Smith no doubt viewed as a money-making effort, but he also was interested in the cafe movie theater as a place where the young people of Calico Rock could go for good and expensive entertainment. Like many other residents of Izard County, Smith resented the backwards image that a large number of Americans held of the White River area, and he determined to do something about breaking the stereotype. Moreover, he was proud of the region's natural beauties and resources and felt they did not receive adequate promotion. Aware of the wealth of musical talent that existed in the immediate vicinity, Smith felt the best means of accomplishing both goals was through giving local musicians greater prominence. With this motive in mind, he organized a fiddle contest that was held in Calico Rock in January 1926. From the winners of this contest, he formed the Horsehair Pullers, and the title coming, of course, from the fact that horsehair sometimes used for the hair of the fiddle bow. So the Horsehair Pullers were fiddlers. And he soon assembled a group of vocalists that he dubbed the Hillbilly Quartet. The next step was to arrange for them to play for a wide audience, so Dr. Smith began plans to get the group on KTHS in Hot Springs, Arkansas, which at that time was 2 years old and was the most powerful station in Arkansas. Smith realized, however, that it would cost a great deal to get such a large group to the radio station, so he arranged for 3 nights of performance at a theater in Hot Springs to offset the travel expense. The initial radio broadcast took place on March 13, 1926, and Smith, who was never one to leave matters to chance, made sure that the event got widespread coverage by inviting columnists for various papers to be guests at the performances. One man, George Moreland, came from Memphis and later wrote a glowing account of his impressions of the Calico Rock Bunch for the commercial appeal. Apparently, Moreland was not the only person who enjoyed the program, for while the group was on the air, a total of 225 telegrams sent in from various states arrived at the station applauding the presentation. Dr. Smith could not have hoped for greater success. Not all of the publicity the Horsehair Pullers received was expected. One impromptu incident that the participants remembered the rest of their lives brought them a great deal of newspaper and radio attention in several states. I've quoted from the Arkansas Gazette of March 16, 1926, and I won't read the entire quote, but merely portions of it so you can get an idea. It all came about when Ray Perryman's car was, Perryman's driver from the group, was struck by another car and offended in it. Patrolman Haney immediately swooped down on Perryman and took him to police headquarters, where by chance the Judge Weiss and Chief of Police Clark heard the story of the accident. Upon learning that the quartet had broadcast from station KTHS at Hot Springs Saturday night, Judge Weiss sought firsthand information as to the quartet's ability to sing. The singing drew such an audience that adjournment was taken from Chief Clark's office to the courtroom where a mock trial was held. Earl Wiseman, a member of the party and an attorney of Calico Rock, appealed to W.T. Pate Jr. in an effort to have the party released. When Mr. Pate reached Little Rock, he found that he was stuck for a box of cigars. He entered into the spirit of the joke and helped to convict members of the party for their actions. The visitors claimed to be musicians and substantiated the claim saying, "I want to get along down the line." It was very appropriate, and after several spectators had been fined to help pay for the dinner, they sang, "It hurts, oh how it hurts." As the party started on its way again, the quartet sang, "It's not so bad after all." During the week after the Horsehair Pullers appeared on KTHS, the station received several telegrams and phone calls asking for the band's return. Still, it was over a month before the group made its second appearance in Hot Springs. This time, April 27, 1926, Smith's aggregation was billed as the Horsehair Pullers the Hillbilly Duet, and the Hillbilly Quartet. Smith waxed romantic in his introductory address given over the air prior to his band's second radio performance. And I quote, "It is indeed gratifying to know our program has made so many minds and hearts drift back to the earlier days when all was well, when the horsehair pullers of old were in due form, and all parties concerned were in a receptive mood for tipping of the fantastic toe. Those days are gone, yet the memory lurks with us still. We take this opportunity to boost the White River Country and the Missouri Pacific Company. My aggregation from this district claims that their music and songs are not suggestive of anything except good and wholesome exercise." And he went on, and finally he concluded in a boastful manner, "So everybody come to the Arkansas Ozarks, where you can eat the best fruit in the world, where home-cured meat is found in the smokehouse and corn and hay in the barn, where you can juice your own cow, feed your own chickens, fish in the wonderful White River, meet these men of the Missouri Pacific and natives, and you will then say, yes, indeed, you have the most wonderful country in the world." Smith returned with his group to one final appearance on KTHS on December 20, 1926. While these radio performances were successful, the distance between Calico Rock and Hot Springs, about a 5-hour drive today, quite a bit more at that time, made for a very tiring trip on the primitive roads of the 1920s. Moreover, having achieved a certain degree of fame, the group was able to stay busy closer to home. Most weekends found them performing at some theater in Izard or nearby counties, and occasionally for Missouri Pacific Railroad functions. They also played their music for high school chapel programs, sometimes going as far as Little Rock. While band members usually made a little money from their appearances, they mainly considered a venture, a lark, rather than a means of making a living. On September 12, 1928, Smith's band recorded six sides for Victor Recording Company in Memphis. According to some of the band members, the group was told to play anything they wanted as long as it was not under copyright. The group tried, but they did not entirely succeed in doing only public domain material, for at least one of their songs was still under copyright protection. The six selections range from religious songs to coon songs to folk songs. Smith followed a practice standard among early rural recording groups in copywriting the songs under the names of various band members. Or actually, this decision may have been made by the record company rather than the horsehair pullers. In any case, there is nothing unusual about the 19th century ballad "In the Garden Where the Irish Potatoes Grow" being assigned to fiddler Clark Duncan. It is tempting to say that the horsehair pullers made records that were bestsellers, but there's nothing to base such an assertion on. Sales figures are, apparently, no longer available, and anything else would be largely guesswork. The fact that the group made no further recordings is perhaps sufficient indication that their records did not sell in enormous quantities. Nevertheless, it seems certain that they were not exactly poor sellers either. According to surviving band members and some other local residents, the 78s did a steady business in Calico Rock, but it seems clear that sales outside the Ozarks were virtually nil. Although the recording experience was the group's high point, Smith's band stayed together for another 2 years. Perhaps "together" is too strong a word, for the personnel shifted slightly at almost every performance. At no time did the Horsehair Pullers and Hillbilly Quartet have more than 8 members, but a total of 13 men belonged to the organization over the years of its existence. One reason why the membership kept changing was Dr. Smith's penchant for sponsoring instrumental contests and adding the winners to his group. On one occasion, he held a French harp contest, the winner becoming a member of his band for a couple of performances. Typically, Smith ballyhooed these contests with a newspaper ad. For example, the April 4, 1930 issue of the Calico Rock Progress contained the following notice: "Boys, get your old jugs out and tune them up. Dr. Smith contemplates staging a jug-blowing contest at an early date. He desires to add a real jug blower to his horsehair pullers. Now is your chance to juggle the jug and expand your lungs. Get jugs of different sizes and tune them to chords, same as that of band instruments. It can be done." And after 4 years, the Horsehair Pullers and Hillbilly Quartet broke up in 1930. To some extent, a victim of their success. The band's fame had grown, and they were being called on more often to provide entertainment throughout northern Arkansas. What had begun, at least for the musicians, as just an enjoyable pastime, was now becoming almost a full-time job, thereby losing much of its appeal. Those men with families saw that soon they would have to make a choice between home life and entertaining and opted for the former. Then, Smith, as a doctor, simply did not have the time to devote to the group that it obviously was going to require. So, shortly after the onset of the Great Depression, Calico Rock's most famous musical work came to an end. Dr. Smith outlasted his band by only a short time. On October 14, 1931, while driving to Little Rock, he suffered a cerebral hemorrhage. He was taken to a hospital, but he never regained consciousness. Thus, at the age of 50, the life of one of Izard County's leading citizens ended. Nearly 1,000 people attended a funeral, which was held in the spacious Spring Creek Methodist Church. And certainly this was a large turnout anywhere, but especially in a town which then had a population of less than 800. That crowd is not the only indication of the esteem in which Dr. Smith was held. Today, over a half century after his death, he is still fondly remembered by residents of Calico Rock, and that is perhaps the best possible testimony to the character of this remarkable citizen of North Arkansas. Now, I'll skip over at this point. I've discussed the various individual members of the band, and I'll include the last section of the paper. Reconstructing the biography of a band that broke up over 50 years ago is difficult, but nothing compared to the task of trying to reconstruct the repertoire. Ordinarily, one might rely on the recorded work, but Smith's group made only 6 sides during their 4 years, so obviously the records do not even contain a sizable percentage of their repertoire. Of their 6 cuts, there is one ballad that can be traced back to the 19th century, one traditional song made up mainly of floating verses, one religious song, 2 coon songs, and a sentimental number. This selection could probably be considered representative of the breadth of the band's repertoire, especially since some former members have said that is the case, but this selection is also misleading in some ways. For example, several persons interviewed during the past 5 years recall that Smith's group featured a large number of comedy and gospel songs in their stage presentations. The former are well represented on the 1928 recordings, but gospel items are not. Perhaps the most interesting of the 6 sides is In the Garden Where the Irish Potatoes Grow, a traditional ballad also known in the Arkansas Ozarks as the B.B. Blossom. Thought to date back to the mid-19th century, the song is more common in oral tradition than its appearance in folk song collections indicates. Apparently, Carl Sandburg is the only folk song collector to publish it, and he gives only 2 verses. It appears in his The American Song Bag under the title, I Met Her in the Garden Where the Prairies Grow. Sandburg tells nothing about the history of the song and reveals very little about its sources, but he does note that a C.W. Lautzenheiser, a retired Chicago railroad worker, recalls singing the number with an Irish girl when, as a boy, he traveled with his father's circus. Since Sandburg's collection was published in 1927, this dates the song back at least to the 1870s. The exact source of Smith's version is unknown, but it was contributed by band member Lehman Bone, who found it in an old songbook. I'm uncertain whether this was a published volume or merely a handwritten book of songs. In any case, Smith's version is the longest version of this song yet recorded. Of the other 5 songs recorded by Smith's band, only one can be traced to a specific author. This is the religious number, Up in Glory, the only one of their 6 sides under copyright protection in 1928. This is also the most unusual of the recordings by the Horsehair Pullers, the hymn's mournful tune contrasting sharply with their other selections. The number is the work of one of the most prolific gospel songwriters of the 20th century, James Rowe, who is perhaps best known as the author of Love Lifted Me. Going Down the River, is credited to one of the singers, Odie in Smith's band, Odie Gocher, which may mean that he contributed the item to the group, or it may indicate nothing more than that Smith selected him at random to receive title credit. It is obvious from the record that Odie Gocher and Roosevelt Garner, another member of the Hillbilly Quartet, listed in the Victor Master book as basses or the leads for this song. Certainly Gocher did not write the piece, for it is a widely known folk song, versions of which were recorded by Al Hopkins and his Buckle Busters and the Winging String Band. About the other three numbers recorded by the Horsehair Pullers, very little information can be provided at present. Save My Mother's Picture from the Sale was located by Lehman Bone, an old songbook, and it was recorded by Uncle Dave Macon, among others, in addition to Smith's band. Ostensibly, the song was in existence for some time prior to 1928, but to my knowledge, its exact origin is unknown. Certainly, it is in spirit akin to such tearjerkers as Gussie Davis's "He Carved His Mother's Name Upon a Tree" of 1895, and Harry Kennedy's 1878 hit "Flower from Angel Mother's Grave," and it probably also originated during that same period. Possibly the same assessment holds for "Give Me the Leavings" and "Little Nigger Baby," which, if they did not originate during the coon song era of 1895, roughly 1895 to 1920, were definitely influenced by that pop music phenomenon. Both songs have the indelible stamp of that unfortunate period when black skin was thought to be inherently funny and black males were stereotyped in an excessively negative way. "Give Me the Leavings" presents the watermelon-loving, happy-go-lucky black, while "Nigger Baby" gives a more vicious, razor-toting image of black men, implying that they relish being regarded as cutters. These are songs of a type that will probably never be publicly popular. Obviously, though, a generation that chuckled over the routines of the two black crows and the like regarded such items in a different light. These songs were intended as comedy and sold as such. So much for the recorded repertoire. What other songs did the Horsehair Pullers perform on stage? Here, there are only a few clues, although at least there is considerable certainty about the type of song. All available evidence indicates that Smith's group generally included a large number of religious and comic songs in their programs, as well as the expected fiddle tunes. When it comes to naming individual selections, though, few informants can furnish even one title. One man, Graydon Bone, recalls that one of the songs the quartet sang on a number of occasions during his tenure with the band was "Jacob's Ladder." Unfortunately, that is the only religious song title other than the one they recorded that anyone now remembers being performed by the group. One of the fiddlers, Brian Lackey, remembered that Smith especially liked the fiddle tune he called "Flatbed Charlie," a traditional item more commonly known as "Oklahoma Charlie" or "White River Charlie." The only other tune he recalled Smith's band doing was "Wednesday Night Waltz," one of the top country instrumentals of the 1920s. As might be expected, after more than 50 years, not much of the repertoire of the Horsehair Pullers can be reconstructed. Including the six recorded sides, only nine tunes can be definitely associated with them. Yet this small total is sufficient to verify the testimony of various informants about the nature of the band's programs. There is little doubt that the material the band performed was tightly controlled by Smith. The usual procedure prior to leaving for performance was for the band to run through every number they intended to play, and Smith would then decide whether the selections were appropriate for the audience or if they should be replaced by other items. This great sensitivity to those listening to the music is perhaps one reason why the programs put on by the Horsehair Pullers are still fondly recalled over half a century after the group passed out of existence. I want to play one selection, and I apologize for the sound. These were taken off of 78s and did the best job I could. This is the least offensive coon song called "Give Me the Leavings."
enough for the herd to get strong. The hardest jobs don't come our way while the herd gets a song. Now in the future, if a good day comes along my way, and then as usual, passes by, I'm simply going to see. Just give me the leaving when you get through. Just give me the leaving, and that will do. Then once put a little bit here below, from with a little bit seems to grow, and the rest well now, ask one more, but the leaving. I was thinking about the pleasant things that walk for me in store. I eat in watermelon and I get them more and more. When I got there, I thought I'd hear my yell of big surprise. So I stepped right into the room and there before my eyes, I saw her just a puppet and a kitchen knife in it. I dropped my knob on the floor and mournfully I said, just give me the leaving when you get through. Just give me the leaving and that will do. Man, walk but a little bit where we go. Song and a little bit keep you strong. That's where now don't ask for more but leaving.
I had a picture of Dr. Smith thinking about 1915. It was on the cover of